The Queen fought the war out of uniform. She identified with the wives and mothers who carried on everyday life. The wartime Ministry of Information liked the civilian theme too and produced, for propaganda consumption, a bicycling royal family, which could be appreciated by a country in which petrol, food and clothes were all carefully rationed. Now the war had become very much a real one. When the cities of Britain were bombed, the King and Queen were quickly out and about to show themselves among the ruins, to comfort and cheer the survivors. The King's devotion through the bad days did much to sustain the country and to sap his own strength. Princess Elizabeth joined a special troop of girl guides at Windsor Castle, where Princess Margaret and she were shut away. The King wouldn't send his daughters to the safety of Canada. When the Queen was asked about this, she said, "The children won't leave without me, and I can't leave without the King, and the King will never leave." So the princesses lived at Windsor, within sight of the bombing of London, and were taught by a governess, and got to know a few other quite carefully selected girls. The heir apparent got her own office and a small household. She began a lifetime's reading of current affairs. The Vice Provost of Eton gave her a good grounding in constitutional history. She did well at it, not so well at mathematics. In early 1945, her father finally allowed her to join the ATS, the Women's Auxiliary of the Army. Second Subaltern Elizabeth Windsor trained as a driver and a motor mechanic. "We had sparking plugs all through dinner last night," her mother said. Now the bombing was almost over. Victory was in sight. After the war, the last of the great British battleships, HMS Vanguard, carried the royal family to South Africa. Coming as it did after long and desperate years, the voyage into the sun gave them all a brief escape. The King had gone to thank South Africa for its part in the war. But that wasn't all that was in his mind or his elder daughters. For Princess Elizabeth was in love with a young man called Philip Mountbatten and meant to marry him. She was suddenly grown up. She broadcast to the Commonwealth on her 21st birthday.
"I declare before you all that my whole life, whether it be long or short, shall be devoted to your service and to the service of our great imperial family to which we all belong. But I shall not have strength to carry out this resolution alone unless you join in it with me, as I now invite you to do. I know that your support will be unfailingly given. God help me to make good my vow, and God bless all of you who are willing to share in it."
The engagement was announced soon after they got home. He had long been known to the family, a nephew of Lord Mountbatten, a prince of Greece, and descendant of Danish royalty, now a lieutenant in the Royal Navy. He'd fought in the Mediterranean and had been mentioned in dispatches. He was intelligent, energetic, and extrovert, entirely British in attitudes and upbringing. On November the 20th, 1947, they were married in Westminster Abbey. The king was ill. He didn't want to lose his daughter, but the marriage was a reassurance. At the day's end, the young couple were cheered along the embankment and over Westminster Bridge on their way to honeymoon at Broadlands, the Mountbatten home in Hampshire. And somehow a corgi was smuggled into the act. Possibly for the only time in her life, the princess enjoyed an everyday, ordinary life. Her husband, though he was now Duke of Edinburgh, was also a serving naval officer and a very competent one. He was posted to Malta, promoted lieutenant commander, and given command of the frigate Magpie. In 1948, their first child was born, Charles Philip Arthur George, Prince Charles. It was the start of a new royal family, which was to be as close and united as the princess's own one had been. Princess Margaret, slightly surprised by the name, resigned herself to the role, she said, of Charlie's aunt. In 1950, there was a daughter, Anne Elizabeth Louise. Again, the family gathered to celebrate, but there was now a shadow over the family. The king was gravely ill with lung cancer. He had relapses and recoveries, but he grew visibly frailer. He had to give up the idea of touring abroad. In January 1952, Princess Elizabeth and her husband flew to East Africa. The king went to London Airport to see them leave. It was the last time she was to see him. The young woman he had brought up to succeed him. The princess and her husband had already done well in Canada and the United States. Now they were heading for Australia and New Zealand. But on the way, they visited Kenya, still a British colony, and went to the highlands for a few peaceful days at a place called Treetops in the Aberdare Forest Game Reserve. King George died in his sleep in the early hours of February the 6th. Before the day was out, the princess knew she was a princess no longer. It was her ministers who met her at the airport on her return, Mr. Churchill, the Prime Minister, at their head. As in all her long reign, she began it with simple dignity. At the age of 25, in the pain of her bereavement, Elizabeth became Queen of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, head of the Commonwealth, and defender of the faith. more than a year later, on June the 2nd, 1953, that she was crowned Queen Elizabeth II. It was hoped this would mark the dawning of a new Elizabethan golden age. And the hope was strengthened by the coincidence that on coronation morning the news broke that the British expedition had conquered Mount Everest at last. It gave at least an extra glitter to the day. 500,000 people lined the streets. 74 countries sent their representatives. 40,000 tourists came from the United States, 60,000 from Australia. And 20 million got to watch it all on television.
I here present unto you Queen Elizabeth, your undoubted queen. Wherefore, all you who are come this day to do your homage and service, are you willing to do the same? Solemnly promise and swear to govern the peoples of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, the Union of South Africa, Pakistan, and Ceylon, and of your possession and the other territories to any of them belonging or pertaining, according to their respective laws and customs.
I solemnly promise so to do.
And with the garment of salvation. O God, the crown of the faithful, bless, we beseech thee, this crown, and so sanctify thy servant Elizabeth, upon whose head this day thou dost place it for a sign of royal majesty.
Thank you.
coronation was followed by a great tour of the countries of her Commonwealth to see the splendor and variety of her territories and peoples and to be seen by them. It's become part of her life now. No monarch has ever traveled so far or so unflaggingly, the first to circumnavigate the world. There aren't so many trains now, more airports and walkabouts, but the curiosity, now as then, is unmatched. They came home in the middle of May 1954. These were still grey days for Britain. It was no longer the power that had fought in the war from the first day to the last. It no longer had the old industrial muscle. But the great majority of the people were still thankful that the monarchy survived to give a sense of stability and continuity. Even then, it was plainly in safe hands. As a constitutional monarch, the Queen has nothing to do with party politics. The government of the day is her government because it's the choice of her people. But her rights are confined to the right to be consulted, the right to encourage, and the right to warn. The Queen's speech is actually written by the Prime Minister.
My Lords and members of the House of Commons, at home, my government's first concern will be to strengthen the economy and curb the inflation. Rising production and a steadily growing national income must provide the resources for improving the social services and the environment in which we live. A bill will be introduced to establish...
The government has alternated fairly evenly between Conservative and Labour. Great issues have been fought over. The ending of empire, joining Europe in the common market, the conflict in Northern Ireland, the war to recover the Falklands, social spending, and always the economy. Her prime ministers have respected her experience and judgment. Harold Wilson has admitted, if she quoted a state document I hadn't read, I felt like a schoolboy who hadn't done his homework. Lord Hume of the Herstal says, her experience is readily put at the disposal of the prime minister and is invaluable. She's always up to date and fully versed in the niceties of every national and international problem. In 1963, she went to see the ill Harold Macmillan in hospital. It fell to her and her advisers to pick his successor. In any drawn election now, she'll have to help the political parties work out how her government is to be carried on. The Queen is the leader of society, the fount of honor. In a democratic age, many of the old anachronisms and snobberies and taboos have been abandoned. It hasn't been done in a dramatic way, but quietly and gradually and effectively. More than any of her predecessors, she's met and has enjoyed meeting people of all walks of life. State visits have been a recurring duty, receiving them and making them. Foreign heads of state are invited by the government for reasons of state, but it's the Queen's job to be pleasant to them all. When King Faisal of Saudi Arabia came to London in May 1967, he was already in action. The Queen at 60 is an abiding, enduring figure, playing hostess to heads of state who fall to election defeat or revolution or even assassination. In the ritual of her state occasions, there's the expression of the stability of generations. She inherited her father's great men and some of their illusions. Churchill was old, ill, and gallant to her. She found him rather obstinate. On his resignation in 1955, she graced a dinner at number 10. Within a year, Eden launched Britain on its last Middle East intervention, when by air and land, Britain joined France and Israel in attacking Nasser's Egypt. World pressure, American especially, forced a withdrawal. The Suez Canal stayed blocked for many years. The British Empire was coming to an end. The African and Caribbean politicians won independence and joined the Commonwealth. In Kenya, Jomo Kenyatta, imprisoned in the campaign against the Mau Mau guerrillas, became president. British jails were a step to power. The Queen insisted on visiting Ghana when President Nkrumah was in trouble. She would do her duty. It went off well. French-speaking Quebec does not admire British royalty. The Queen went there to thin applause in 1964. She would not be put off. She has travelled the world tirelessly, Commonwealth or not, as the embodiment of Britain. It's diplomacy and hard selling around her for new export orders. And having a queen coming to call is still a little bit flattering and a good chance to show off a little. It wouldn't be Brazil without a carnival. The great subcontinent of India had split into two competing countries, Pakistan and India. The Queen went to see them both, and they treated her as if the Raj of her forebears had never been abolished. Even in Africa, which was to be beset too often through the years by dictatorships, civil wars, and famines where food had been in surplus, her presence meant a holiday. She least of all has ever supposed that a state visit solves anything much. She least of all has ever imagined that the progress of independent Africa into the 21st century will be other than difficult and slow. But she has always wanted and tried to help behind the scenes. The Commonwealth Conference in Lusaka in 1979, when it seemed that the continued illegal independence of the white minority in Rhodesia would split the Commonwealth irretrievably, the Queen helped to save the day by calming, restraining the Prime Ministers and helping them with her experience. The course was set for the Lancaster House Conference in London, elections, and a legal black government in Zimbabwe.
Thank you.
The Queen has dealt with several women prime ministers in her time. With Mrs. Gandhi in India, she felt she had a friend who respected the Commonwealth and Indian democracy. She's had to be patient, and even for a queen, long-suffering. Sometimes her Commonwealth ministers don't do what she wants. Sometimes they don't even turn up on time. But she's been faithful to the ideal her father began, and to which she has devoted so much of her time and her hopes. The poverty of many of the new Commonwealth countries brought increasing troubles to Britain itself. Black families flocked in from Asia and the West Indies to find work. For the first time, Britain found it had a serious colour problem. Unemployment, especially among black youths, and the spread of the drug culture have been instrumental in setting off riots in England's inner cities. The police, in turn, have become the target for attacks in Brixton, Tottenham, Bristol, Birmingham, and for growing political abuse. Economic worries and political agitation turned some strikes into violent confrontations. There was fighting on the picket lines outside the Grundwick Company. Again, the police stood in the front line. The strike by two-thirds of the coal miners, led by Arthur Scargill in 1984, brought the worst violence since the early years of the century. The miners were beaten. The Queen is known to have been unhappy that such a conflict could happen in modern Britain. In Northern Ireland, the conflict between Protestant and Roman Catholic was hereditary. The police could not cope with a campaign by the IRA and the paramilitary demonstrations of its supporters and opponents. The troops had to be called in. The Queen herself went in 1977 by helicopter, though she hates helicopters. Queen's country has had its high days too. It was an Englishman, Dr. Roger Bannister, who became the first man ever to run a mile in under 4 minutes. It was the Anglo-French Concorde that was the first, up to now the only airliner in regular supersonic service. It cost the taxpayers plenty, but they were getting used to that. And in the most important invasion of America since the Pilgrim Fathers landed on the Pilgrim Rock, the Beatles from Liverpool put themselves and British pop music at the top of the world charts. They've been years in which the English theatre has flourished as never before. Olivier, Gielgud, Richardson, Ashcroft, Jackson, and both the Redgraves. And painting. Sutherland, Rathby, Bacon, Alan Jones, and perhaps the epitome of the times, David Hockney from Bradford. Even British football has done its bit. In the summer of 1966, England won the World Cup at Wembley. The Queen naturally was there to hand the cup over. She may have suspected it would be quite a few years before she'd need to congratulate them again. Making a difference to the British scene. It didn't save Britain from high unemployment, but it saved it from the worst of the 1980s depression. It's been Conservative Prime Ministers who put through the biggest changes in her reign. Edward Heath signed Britain into the European Common Market in 1972. Margaret Thatcher, the Queen's eighth Prime Minister, won her way into power in 1979, a politician of firm conviction, a stern nurse intent on trying to get the country's economy out of bed. Mrs. Thatcher refused to accept the Argentine seizure of the Falkland Islands and sent a strong task force to recover them. Argentine Air Force had other ideas. The Queen's second son, Prince Andrew, was there as a co-pilot in a Royal Navy helicopter. Once British troops were ashore, the outcome was certain. They set off across the bleak hills and marshes to deal with the Argentine occupiers. It was a short, sharp, successful campaign. Many of the Argentine forces were young conscripts, already dispirited. They had little faith in their officers, their officers little in them. The guards and the paratroopers pushed on into the capital, Fort Stanley, and the islands were British again. Their first thought, a message of loyalty to the Queen. Britain itself had taken the Queen to its heart in her silver jubilee year 1977. A little to her surprise, they cheered her to the echo. And a little to Parliament's surprise, she had a very clear view to express on public policy and the unity of the country.
The problems of progress, the complexities of modern administration, the feeling that metropolitan government is too remote from the lives of ordinary men and women. These, among other things, have helped to revive an awareness of historic national identities in these islands. They provide the background for the continuing and keen discussion of proposals for devolution to Scotland and Wales within the United Kingdom. I number kings and queens of England and of Scotland and princes of Wales among my ancestors. And so I can readily understand these aspirations. But I cannot forget that I was crowned Queen of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. Perhaps this jubilee is a time to remind ourselves of the benefits which union has conferred at home and in our of all parts of this United Kingdom.
Features for Her Majesty the Queen. Hip, hip, hip.
Rode through the crowds to the service of St. Paul's Cathedral.
Lord, behold,
Guildhall, the Queen recalled the promise she had made in South Africa 30 years before.
My Lord Mayor, when I was 21, I pledged my life to the service of our people, and I asked for God's help to make good that vow. Although that vow was made in my salad days when I was green in judgment, I do not regret nor retract one word of it.
Her particular pleasure through the years has been in the success of her children. When Prince Charles was 21 at Carnarvon Castle, she invested him Prince of Wales. Princess Anne earned great distinction as a horsewoman, especially in the most testing competition of the three-day event. In 1971, she became the European individual champion. Two years later, the princess went to Westminster Abbey to be married to a young officer of the Queen's Dragoon Guards, who was also an international rider, Captain Mark Phillips.
Let no man put asunder.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Just been to the Abbey for a service on the 25th anniversary of the Queen and Prince Philip's wedding.
God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully with his favor look upon you, and so fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace, that ye may so live together in this life, that in the world to come ye may have life everlasting. Amen.
From the Abbey, they rode again to Guildhall.
I think everybody really will concede that on this, of all days, I should begin my speech with the words, "My husband and I." We, and by that I mean both of us, are most grateful. Grateful to you for your generous welcome and for the kind and thoughtful way in which you have expressed the city's loyalty and affection. We thank you also for your beautiful and generous gift. I must confess, my Lord Mayor, that it came as a bit of a surprise to realize that we had been married 25 years. Neither of us are much given to looking back, and the years have slipped by so quickly. Now that we have reached this milestone in our lives, we can see how immensely lucky we have been, or perhaps fortunate might be a better word. We had the good fortune to grow up in happy and united families. We have been fortunate in our children. And above all, we are fortunate in being able to serve this great country and Commonwealth.
Racing has always been a great hobby. Being with horses, breeding her own winners, has been a passion. Dunfermline, the filly who won both the Oaks and the St. Ledger in 1977, has been the most successful of her horses.
Dunfermline on the near side, having a right battle with Freezer Tinker as they pass the pearl on from home market. It's Franco Dottori on Freezer Tinker. On the near side, Willie Carson, Dunfermline. And it's going to be a royal victory, I think. On the near side, Dunfermline. And Dunfermline now going into the lead. And Dunfermline wins the Oaks from Freezer Tinker.
But she hasn't won the Derby yet. Grandchildren have come on the scene. The Queen, in her Christmas broadcast to the Commonwealth in 1978, left the last words to the new generation, her first grandchild, Master Peter Phillips. The country was delighted. Master Phillips and friend had a lot going for them. The family has had its troubles, like all families. This was the year of her sister, Princess Margaret's divorce after a two-year separation. But the family has held together. The Queen has kept it together. Her father would have approved.
No.
In the summer of 1981, the country put its troubles and preoccupations aside for a day. The Prince of Wales, the heir to the throne, was getting married. The bride, Lady Diana Spencer, was just 20. And 750 million people around the world watched all day on television. To the generation of the children of the Prince and Princess of Wales, Prince William and Prince Harry, who stand second and third in succession, the hopes of the country over which Elizabeth II has reigned will one day devolve. In that age, she will be venerated, a monarch of authority and experience, as Britain and the world have not seen since her great-great-grandmother, Queen Victoria. To those who have lived in her now lengthy reign, her 60th year has added to all the years in which she has stood nearby the crown and worn the crown in the affection and respect that she has earned from all that she has met. From the little girl who astonished Churchill by her authority and reflectiveness, to the woman whom the world acknowledges as an example and figure of our times, the Queen has made it a 60th birthday to be remembered.
Perhaps some of the mysteries of Queen Elizabeth are now revealed. Well, who built Stonehenge, that circle of Neolithic stones? Subject of speculation, and we'll try to answer some of those questions in the next documentary. Here is British Night Continues, and here's more of what you'll see